right? When we say the word green, the first thing that comes to our mind is nature, trees, pleasant environment, yes or no? And when we say the word chemistry, we start visualizing dirty apparatus, smell, labs, then burns on the skin, lab accidents, all these things, right? These two are very two contradictory words together, okay? Now, the reason why we need to know this is why exactly we need to modify chemistry. Why is this green word combined with chemistry? Okay, this is the reason is the way we are using or overusing the things around us. Whenever we just throw everything outside, we think that okay, our house is clean. But then throwing these waste outside, what happens to these waste? Have you ever realized that when you like walk on the road, sometimes you must have seen these old cars lying besides the road, yes or no, on the sides of the roads, right? So what happens to these cars? Have you ever realized that? So what exactly now we can do is we are going to modify chemistry in such a way that all these waste that are generated, okay, we have studied the chapter of herbicides and pesticides, how these synthetic herbicides and pesticides are harmful to everyone, right? So what we can do by using chemistry. So what green chemistry says is it is the invention, designs and applications, okay, invention, designs and applications of chemical products and processes to reduce or eliminate the use and generation of hazardous substances. What does that mean? You design the synthesis in such a way, okay, you invent a new synthesis that whatever you are synthesizing and whatever products we are synthesizing or we are inventing, these processes or the products should be such that they should be able to reduce or eliminate the use of hazardous substances. Okay. So what exactly we need to do over here? So green chemistry basically believes in conservation of energy, waste minimization, that means try to produce minimum waste as much as possible, and substitution. Substitute if a reaction is giving you a lot of waste product, substitute that product. If the process is hazardous, substitute that product. Okay, this is the concept of green chemistry, and it also focuses on reducing the cost of the product as well as the reactant or the whole process, reducing the energy required for the reaction, use of non-renewable, reducing the use of non-renewable, and encouraging use of renewable sources, reducing the risk, reducing the waste, reducing the material. Okay, so we say that reducing is the heart of green chemistry. Always remember these three R's: reduce, reuse and recycle. Okay, very very important. You're going to look at this chapter not as a chapter to score marks, but as something that you are going to apply in your day-to-day life. Okay, these are the different terminologies for green chemistry. It can be also called as environmentally benign chemistry, clean chemistry, sustainable chemistry. Okay, green chemistry aims to conserve both energy and raw materials. Even you can apply this chemistry in your day-to-day life, conservation of energy. Green processes are cheaper compared to the conventional methods. We will see why they are cheaper. They prevent production of hazardous and polluting materials, so the whole process or the products that are formed will be less hazardous. Green chemistry is definitely safe. It conserves raw materials. It is cost effective. Okay. Now, all these things are achieved by the 12 principles of green chemistry. So, whenever we study green chemistry or whenever we want to apply green chemistry, whenever we are designing a new synthesis or getting a new product, all these principles have to be taken into mind. Are you understanding this? You have to keep in mind all these principles and then design your new synthesis, which will be a green synthesis. Okay, so we are going to study all these points one by one. Now, the first and the most important point is prevention. You must have heard of this proverb, prevention is better than cure. Okay, so to cure a disease, it takes time, it takes efforts, it takes money. So it is better to prevent ourselves from getting that disease. Yes or no? So prevention is always better than cure. Same thing is applicable to chemistry also. Now, last time I had told you this example of diapers. Yes or no? Decomposition of these diapers or the plastic can take 200 to 500 years. So they stay accumulated here for so many years, and there is no option for us to stay and be there. Yes or no? So it's like you are not able to decompose it, you're not able to dispose it. What are you going to do? Okay, they are going to stay in the environment. So what is, if something is going to stay in the environment for so long, why not to substitute this product with something else? Okay, why not to prevent the use of such type of products? Why not to prevent the generation of such waste in our environment? Okay, so the first principle of green chemistry is it is better to prevent the waste than to treat it up or clean it up. Okay, and generally we have a common practice to dump everything outside. You go to beach, you take Lay's ka packet, wafers ka packet, you eat it and you just dump it on the, seashore. Yes or no? How many of you do that? Don't do that if you people are doing it. You are going by train or you're going by bus. You just throw the ticket outside. Someone is eating banana. Pekele ka chilka bahar fek diya. Santre ka chilka bahar fek diya. Nothing. Apne paas nahi hai, toh ho gaya. Sab clean ho gaya. It's not like that. All these things, they stay in the environment. But kele ka chilka and santre ka chilka is what? It is organic. It will decompose. But then we just eat some wafers and everything and just throw that plastic outside. Yes or no? That is very bad because plastic is non-decomposable, non-biodegradable, and it will stay there as long as nobody removes it, because it is not going to be biodegradable and it will not decompose. Okay, so we have to carry out cleaning of all this waste or waste treatment. Okay, we have a habit of dumping everything in water. That is also very bad practice. If you or any family member is doing this, ask them to stop. You people are chemistry students. You have much better knowledge about all these chemical products than anyone else. So start becoming a good citizen. Okay. So in chemistry, when we start synthesizing something, there are some unreacted starting materials also, okay, which is called as waste. What we do generally, ki exam lab mein we give you 2 grams of material, you generate only 0.4 grams of product. 1.6 gram of material is wasted and we just throw it in the dustbin. What happens to that chemical waste? Yes or no? So the unreacted starting material forms a waste. The solvents form a waste. So it is better to carry out a synthesis that formation of waste is minimized. You design your new synthesis in such a way that the process involves pathways to give products, leaving no waste or minimum waste, so that very less waste is used or is remaining to treat or clean up. Are you getting this? So what is our first principle? Prevention. What have you understood about prevention? Anyone, can you just give me your understanding in your own words or in any languages in 1 or 2 lines? Anyone can unmute yourself and tell me. What have you understood of prevention? Anyone? Come on. Hello? The chemistry, what you are going to do? You will design a process in such a way that waste generation will be less. So you are preventing the generation of waste. That is the takeaway of this principle. Are you getting this? What are we preventing over here? Remember this. We are preventing the generation of waste. Is that clear to you? Okay. Okay, let's go for the next. Atom economy. Now, I just gave you an example. Ki in lab, when we give you something to synthesize, most of the students will give us a weight of, say, product like, say, 0.5 gram, 0.6 gram. What happens to the rest of the reactant? It is generated as waste. Yes or no? What happens is we are not able to convert 100% of the reactant to 100% of the product. Okay, and because of this, there are undesired products that is considered as waste. okay, and the whole process becomes uneconomical, uneconomical. Yes or no? अभी तुम लोग लैब में रहते हो तो स्टूडेंट्स का क्या रहता है, यू नो व्हाट इज द मेंटालिटी? अरे हम लोगों ने पैसा भरा है, तोड़ वो कुछ नहीं, के लिए फ्री में है, सब सॉल्यूशंस फ्री में है. सो यू पीपल यू नो यहाँ चलेगा कितना, थोड़ा सा अल्कोहल चाहिए, पूरा टेस्ट ट्यूब भर के अल्कोहल लोगे. दिस इज वॉट स्टूडेंट्स डू. ओके, दिस इज अ नेचुरल टेंडेंसी बिकॉज यू पीपल आर अनअवेयर. नाउ सिंस यू आर अवेयर ऑफ दिस, स्टार्ट यूजिंग ईच एंड एवरी थिंग इन योर डे टू डे लाइफ. मतलब एक सोच समझ के करना. आर यू गेटिंग दिस? ओके, सो वॉट वी डू इन एटम इकोनॉमी, ट्राई टू कन्वर्ट मैक्सिमम ऑफ स्टार्टिंग मटेरियल इन टू फाइनल प्रोडक्ट. So you have to design your synthesis in such a way that most of the starting material gets converted into product. Most of the starting material gets converted into product. This is your maximizing atom economy. Okay. So when we say that most of our starting material is converted to product, that means less waste is generated. Then we are also following the principle, prevention principle, right? So final product should aim to contain all the atoms used in the process. So 100% reactants into product means what? 100% atoms of the reactants are converted to 100% atom of the products. And we have a formula for that. Formula weight, that's the molecular weight of the product divided by sum of the formula weights of the reactants into 100. Okay, can you all see this formula, students? Are you understanding this? This is the formula that you have to learn. Is that clear to you? Atom economy is formula weight of product upon sum of the formula weights of reactants into 100. So we'll see one example. So we are going to synthesize malic anhydride, and we have three processes over here: benzene, butene, and butane oxidation. This is our starting material. When we use benzene, so what we will do, this is our product, these are our byproducts. So when we find atom economy, we are not concerned about the byproducts. We will just take the formula weight of the product divided by formula weight of the reactants, which are our two reactants, benzene and oxygen. So when you substitute in the formula, we get atom economy of 44.4. Then for butane oxidation, atom economy is 57.64, and for butene it is 64. So what do you think, which one is the best product out of the three, best process out of the three? Anyone? By looking at these percentages, which one is the better process, students? Butene. Now butene, right? Butene. Why butene? Because atom economy is 64.5. What do you mean by 64.5? That means 64.5% of your reactant is converted to that much. So it is not better, but it is not best, but it is better than the other two process. So we will choose a process which has maximum atom economy. Have you understood this? We are going to solve some numericals on this. We will take that in a separate lecture. Okay. Is that clear to you? So what is your takeaway from the principle of atom economy? Try to convert 100% of the reactants into 100% of the product. Design your synthesis in such a way that maximum reactants are converted into products. Have you understood this? Okay. Fine. Now let's come to the next one. Now this is something that we people don't realize, and these are some of the products that we are using every day. Every one of us have these bleaching agents, phenyls. Yes or no? Every one of us have this at home, right? These are the laundry reagents, cleaners, right? Now even this mosquito repellents, I told you last time also, these things, they, when we have these such things which produce gas or strong aroma, these things have a risk of developing asthma in the children. See, these are nothing but your household items only. Bleach causes cancer. Okay, so synthetic solvents, they cause hormone disruption. See how these small things are affecting our body. Women who work from home, the housewives, they have 54% of higher death rate from cancer because of all these items that they are continuously using at home. So at home also we are exposed to lot of pollution than outdoor air pollution. And what is the reason behind this? Because of the synthetic products that we are using. That is why nowadays many people are marketing natural products. Yes or no? Ayurvedic products, right? So what we need to do, we need to design safer chemicals. We cannot stop using these chemicals. So what we have to do, we have to design using safer chemicals. What should be the safer chemicals? The paints, cosmetics, medicines, all should be safe. Are you getting this? Okay. Thalidomide drug, which was used in pregnancy, produced to reduce the effect of nausea and vomiting, resulted in birth defects. So it was helping the mother, but it was affecting the fetus. Are you getting this? Okay. So this drug was banned. So what we have to do, we have to replace this drug with something else which is safer for both. Right. Similarly, we have seen about DDT in the agrochemicals. I told you about DDT. Yes or no? It bioaccumulates in the environment. We consume it. Right. So you have to find an alternative for DDT. So we go for biological pesticides. So what we are doing over here, designing safer chemicals. So what is this principle? The chemical product should be such, or they should be designed to do their job, but minimum harm to the environment and people. Is that clear to you? Okay. If found toxic, then alternatives should be prepared. So if a medicine is found to have lot of side effects, we have to replace that medicine with something else. If a certain chemical that we are using in everyday life, like say phenyl, it is causing a lot of burns on our hand, replace that phenyl with something else, something more natural and something more safe. So you have to design a safer chemical. Getting it? So what does green chemistry emphasize on? To design chemical products which are fully effective and have no toxicity. Have you understood this? Is that clear to you, students? Can you unmute yourself? What was our first principle? Prevention of waste. Okay, your synthesis should be such that minimum waste should be generated, so you are preventing the generation of waste. Second principle was atom economy. Who can tell about atom economy? Atom economy, try to convert maximum atoms into products, reactant atoms into product. And that next one was safer chemicals. Similar to safer chemicals is this. Again, how many of you give clothes for dry cleaning? Your party wear clothes you must be giving for dry cleaning. Yes or no? One or two cloth you must have, dress you must have given for dry cleaning, right? Now, what is dry cleaning? Why we call it as dry cleaning? Does anybody know what is the process of dry cleaning? We don't wash these clothes at home. At home, what do we use for washing our clothes? Soap, sodium salts of fatty acids. Yes or no? In dry cleaning, soap is not used. The cloth is dipped in, or the cloth is exposed to chemicals, volatile chemicals, okay, organic chemicals. And what is that chemical? Perchloroethylene. This is the solvent which is used for dry cleaning. And this solvent is very toxic for human health and environment. See, when you give for dry cleaning, we don't realize what we are doing, students. Okay, the dry cleaning is a luxury that Earth cannot afford because of this solvent. Now, if this solvent is creating so much of problems, and we also want to clean our clothes, we are using such costly clothes, we cannot wash it at home. Now, what is the option? You want to do dry cleaning, but you don't want to cause pollution. So, what to do now? Use safer solvents. Whenever we synthesize anything, we need some solvents. When we carry out reactions, we need some solvents. Yes or no? Can anyone give some examples of solvents which we can use in our reactions? Anyone who can give me some examples of solvents? Yes. Benzene, water, okay. Alcohol. Yes or no? Toluene, right? Out of these, which one is toxic and which one is safer? Water is safer. Yes. Water definitely is a good solvent. Try to design your reactions in such a way that your reactions can be carried out in water. Because what will be the waste generated? Water, no? Right? Benzene is banned. Benzene is carcinogenic. Try to design a synthesis which does not use benzene. Right? Try to design a synthesis which does not need solvents. Okay? Try not to use unnecessary chemicals. If needed, they should not be harmful to the environment. Avoid using solvents, separating agents, and other auxiliary chemicals. Okay, auxiliary chemicals is other chemicals. Sometimes we need protection, deprotection. We are going to see it later in the slides. If you want to use solvent, if there is no option, try to design a synthesis in which water can be used as solvent. There are other eco-friendly solvents like ionic liquids and liquid CO2. Okay, for dry cleaning, perchloroethylene is replaced by liquid CO2. So that is a good news. Now, instead of perchloroethylene, we can use liquid CO2, but not all the laundry people use liquid CO2. Okay, so because of a lot of reasons, unawareness, perchloroethylene maybe is easily available for them. All these things are there. So we have to be a little bit careful. Okay. Now follow all these principles and come to this less hazardous chemical synthesis. You should design a synthesis in such a way that every process, every waste or every reactant that you are using, the whole synthesis becomes less hazardous. So your starting material, your reactant is less hazardous. If your starting material you are selecting, it should be less toxic. Your whole synthesis method, your whole production method should be designed to make substances that are less toxic to people and the environment. Okay? The reactions in which intermediate reagents and products are toxic, don't use that. If you want benzene as an intermediate, as a solvent, replace that benzene with something else. Don't use benzene, it is very toxic. Always try to find alternative pathways. See, these are some of the chemicals, hazardous chemicals, which are generally used in lab and in industries also. And people who are exposed to these chemicals, they suffer a lot of health problems. Remember this. Phosgene, chlorine, bromine. These are very, very harmful chemicals. Even HCl. If you keep continuously exposing yourself to the HCl vapors, that also causes a lot of health effects. Okay, in plants, in huge plants where people are continuously exposed to all this, they suffer a lot of health effect hazards. Remember this. I'm not scaring you from taking a job in industry, but these are some of the facts that you should know. Okay, so one of the example of this is synthesis of indigo dye. You know, na indigo dye. The indigo color that we get on a cloth is because of indigo dye. So what is the traditional method? Aniline, chloroacetic acid is used. So these are the step, soda mine, and then we get this indigo dye. Okay, this is the traditional method. Now in each step, lot of waste product is generated. Okay, chloroacetic acid is also toxic. Sodamide is also toxic. And this has a very low atom economy. That means in each step, lot of waste product is generated. But we need indigo dye for dyeing our clothes. So what should we do? We should design a new synthesis. Take something else. Take a new starting material. So what is our green starting material? Green method, L-tryptophan. Okay. Tryptophanase is the enzyme that is used. Now see, each step is related with using with bacteria or all our biological substances, biosubstances, bioreactants. So definitely if they stay in the environment as byproducts, they are not going to cause any harm to the environment. Because these are all natural, yes or no? Any natural thing doesn't become a pollutant. Any artificial thing always becomes a pollutant. So, what is a green synthesis of indigo dye? L-tryptophan. What is a traditional synthesis of indigo dye? From aniline. Which one is a better synthesis? Which one is a better synthesis? L-tryptophan. Have you understood this principle? Is this clear to you, students? Okay, what are we doing? What have we done exactly over here? What have we done over here? We have changed the whole synthesis. How did we change the synthesis? By using a new starting material, which is natural. Right? Okay. How can you apply something like this in your day-to-day life? Anyone? Anyone? How can you apply this in your day-to-day life? Any example can you give in your day-to-day life where you can prevent something or change something about yourself, which will not cause much pollution? Yes, students? Anyone? Keep this question in mind. I'll come back to you again. Think of something. Let's next is energy efficiency. Okay. Now, most of us have a habit, you know, एक रूम में आए दूसरे रूम का फैन चालू है, टीवी का बटन चालू है. Yes or no? How many of you have this habit? This is energy wastage. In chemistry also, during synthesis also, energy is very important. Now, what is this energy in synthesis? It is in the form of thermal energy. You provide heat. Yes or no? You need heating. You need high temperature to carry out reactions. Yes or no? Okay, drying needs energy. So your reaction should be designed in such a way that it saves lot of energy in the form of heat or whatever. So energy needed to carry out the reaction should be minimized to reduce the economic impact. If possible, processes should be carried out at ambient temperature and pressure. Minimum, like if a reaction is at room temperature, very good reaction. If a reaction is at a normal temperature, normal pressure, very good reaction. But if you are requiring high pressure, for high maintaining high pressure for that equipment also requires a lot of electricity. Maintaining reaction at very high temperature requires a lot of heat energy. Yes or no? So what we can do is to do this, to design this for energy efficiency, what is the best thing to use? Catalyst. So I don't know, have you noticed that if you have to carry out a reaction at say 200 degrees Celsius without a catalyst and with the catalyst, same reaction, will you require the same temperature or less temperature? Anyone? With the catalyst, what happens to the temperature? Will the temperature required will be same or less or more? Anyone? What is? Yes, if it is you are carrying out a reaction say at 150 degrees Celsius, if you use a catalyst, the temperature may be carried at room temperature also, sometimes at 50 or 70 degrees Celsius. What is the other advantage of catalyst? What is the other advantage, students? Speed of the reaction. Yes, 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 that's right. Some reactions take say 10 hours. If you use a catalyst, the same reaction can be converted into 10 minutes. See the difference. Yes or no? Lot of difference. So use catalyst. And by stopping use of fuels, gaseous fuels, which release solid and gaseous pollutants. Change the fuel. Okay. Change the whole process. Instead of heat, try to use microwave radiations. Try to carry out reactions in ultrasonic conditions, ultrasound reactions. Try to use fermentation process. All these processes use very, very less energy. Are you getting this? So you should design a synthesis in such a way that it requires lesser energy. See, in microwave also, you must have observed that when you want to prepare a food on a gas, it may take somewhere around 20 to 30 minutes. Let's take example of tea. You need at least 10 minutes to prepare tea, no? Right? But the same tea, if you prepare in microwave, it hardly takes 2 minutes. Even I've tried idli. Idli takes around 10 minutes, 10 to 15 minutes on gas, but in microwave it's just 3 minutes. So the same thing applies in reactions also. Your reactions time is reduced to a lot of extent when you use microwave radiations. Got it? Okay. Next is renewable feedstock. Feedstock means starting material. Okay. Or the raw material. Whenever possible, try to use renewable feedstock. So what could be a renewable feedstock? Something which is natural, something which is renewable. Okay, anything from the nature will not be a waste. Even if that raw material, which is a natural substance, if it remains as a waste, it will never cause pollution. Remember this. So biodiesel, it's a cleaner renewable energy source. Now, how is biodiesel prepared? Biodiesel is an ester which is obtained. It's an oil which is obtained from seeds of the plants. Jojoba oil, jojoba seeds, soy seeds, palm seeds, okay, animal fat. And it can be used as a replacement to the normal fuels like petrol, kerosene, petrol, diesel, which cause lot of pollution. So instead of using those fuels as fuels, use biodiesel as a fuel. Okay. Pyrolysis of oils. Pyrolysis oils means heating the oils at higher temperature. These pyrolysis oils, which are made from waste wood, agricultural waste. You can use these oils because these things are not going to be considered as waste. These are good sources of raw materials. Okay. They are used to produce high value materials like solvents, detergents to plastic, fibers. They are the cheapest of all the liquid fuels derived from biomass. So definitely these type of fuels are very, very good. Getting it? So examples include crops, woody plants, algae, petroleum, natural gas. Crude oil is a feedstock for production of gasoline. Okay. Algae is a feedstock for production of hydrocarbon fuels. Corn can be used for the production of ethanol. So instead of producing ethanol by hydration reaction of ethene, use corn to produce ethanol. Okay, so this is renewable feedstock. Now, one of the example that is popularly asked for you in exam is synthesis of adipic acid. So this is your adipic acid and it was initially synthesized from benzene. And I told you benzene is carcinogen. Now in labs, benzene is banned. In industries also, you have to get special license for using benzene and alcohol because all these chemicals are not easily available. They are banned and they are carcinogenic. Okay. So benzene is carcinogenic. Each step, lot of waste is generated and you have lot of energy also utilized here. So instead of using benzene, which is a carcinogen, adipic acid can be synthesized from glucose. So glucose is naturally available substance and E. coli bacteria, that is also non-hazardous. So this is a very, very beautiful process for generation of adipic acid. No waste. Even if the waste remains, what will be the waste containing? Glucose, which is biodegradable. E. coli. E. coli is everywhere. It is non-toxic. Yes or no? Right? So this is a method that you have to use. So this is a green process because it replaces benzene. And what is our renewable feedstock over here? Our renewable feedstock is D-glucose. Are you understanding this? Okay. Fine. Okay. Next and very important that you need to apply this in your day-to-day life is reduce, reuse, recycle. Reduce derivatives. What can you reduce, reuse and recycle in your day-to-day life? Anyone? Can anyone come up with an example? I want to hear that example from someone. What is it? What do you think is the need of today to reduce, reuse and recycle? Anyone? That one particular product. Plastic. Yes. Very good. Plastic. Are you people applying this? Reduce, reuse, recycle. If not, do that. We will go to that. Now, I have few slides on that also. You will see how gross that plastic is. Now, coming back to chemistry, in some steps, you know, in some reactions, we have to prepare derivatives to reach from one conversion, functional group conversion to another. So if there are two functional groups and you want only one functional to react. So for that second functional group, we have to carry out steps like protecting and deprotecting. Okay. That means what we are doing, we are increasing steps. We are increasing the chemicals. Okay. We are increasing the formation of derivatives. Okay. So we should design a synthesis that is more selective. You should avoid the use of protecting groups because unnecessarily you are generating waste. You are increasing the time. You are increasing the energy consumption. Okay. So you should design your step in such a way that there are not too many steps in the reaction. Because as the number of steps increases, number of reagents increases, more waste is made. Okay. Instead, you try to use alternative reagents which are more selective. That is how you can reduce the formation of derivatives. And this, yes, you know, one of you just told me the answer, catalysis. Use of catalysis is the best thing that you can do in a reaction. Try to use catalysts because catalysts are more selective. They increase the rate of the reaction. They reduce the energy consumption. They give maximum atom economy. So many principles of green chemistry are sorted by catalyst itself. So reactions that have catalysts are more efficient. Okay. Catalysts carry out reactions without being consumed, so we can reuse that catalyst again and again. Starting material is fully utilized, that means more atom economy, less waste. Catalysts are used in small amounts, so you don't have to use large amount of catalyst, so you are saving that substance also. And one catalyst, because it can be recycled, you can carry out many reactions many times without the catalyst being exhausted. Catalyst reactions are faster, require less energy, and they are very selective in actions. The best catalysts that you can use are biocatalysts, enzymes, bacteria, and everything. Okay. Now, pay attention to this. This is what we are doing. Corona is not generated by nature, it is because of our doings. Okay. When you use plastic, when you are bringing a particular plastic, when you go to the vegetable vendor, see, you know, some people have this tendency, अरे नहीं नहीं अपनी बैग मत निकाल, अरे वो प्लास्टिक का थैली दे रहा है उससे ले ले. Some people have this, you know, negative tendency of collecting the plastic bag. They don't take that cloth bag. Even if they are having cloth bag, they will ask purposely that bhaji wala to give the plastic bag. See what we are doing. You must have seen this, no? Have you seen this when you go to beach and all? You must have seen this waste. You don't even feel like stepping up into that water. See the garbage. These are the real photos of the garbage. This is the kind of garbage we are generating every day. And who is getting harmed? Not only us, the poor aquatic the animals, the aquatic life, the animals on the roads. These things are getting affected. Look at the condition of the animals. Many animals die just by consumption of plastic because they eat the plastic, they don't know what they are eating. We just put our food or the garbage waste in that plastic bag and throw it in the dustbin, and the animals eat that. They consume this plastic and they feel that they have eaten something. Their stomach is full, but what is happening inside their body? They are dying. So whenever you throw something, you know, in a plastic bag, you just think, whenever you're throwing a plastic in water, think what you're doing. Okay? So be careful with this. So why we need to be careful with this? Because plastic doesn't undergo degradation. It is non-biodegradable. So you have to, as a chemist, what we can do, if plastic is not biodegradable and we cannot stop use of plastic, what should we do? We should make plastic biodegradable. Getting it? This is designed for degradation. So if a substance is biodegradable, they don't get accumulated in the environment. So make sure whatever you are designing is biodegradable. Okay? So plastic. Nowadays, new synthesis has been carried out to design a biodegradable plastic. When you design a biodegradable plastic, they break down in the environment. Plastic pesticides are non-biodegradable. Remember this. Okay, the packaging material, polystyrene, non-biodegradable. So alternative to this is biodegradable plastic. And nowadays biodegradable plastic is synthesized from cellulose, okay, or starch. I'll show you some examples. This is environmentally friendly plastic, and this is a biodegradable plastic which can degrade in within, you know, say 90 days or something. So very, very good plastic. So such plastics are available in market. Try to use such type of plastic. Hemp, you must have seen this. So this is designed from hemp, which is a plant which is also biodegradable. You have cornstarch plastic, which is designed from corn, that is also biodegradable. Okay, nowadays to reduce the use of plastic, laws is passed that you stop using plastic, but still you people use plastic. Tell your parents to take a cloth bag every time you go outside for shopping. Please, you also apply the same. You are now aware what happens, what is plastic. Okay, look at this. You should be something like this. Keep such people as your, you know, inspiration. Okay, so this is a plastic waterproof, not exactly plastic, but it is made from bamboo, waterproof, environmentally friendly. Even the cork of the bottles is made up of bamboo. Try to find out, try to advertise such type of products, try to use such type of products, and if you can't, try to reduce the use of plastic in our day-to-day life. Okay, now just give me a few minutes, we are about to finish. Take these principles as some of your life lessons, students. Next is real-time analysis. Real-time analysis means what? Sometimes in your reactions, you know, there is a particular temperature or particular time at which a toxic material or toxic waste product is generated. You have to monitor your reaction in such a way that you come to know ki, okay, after 1 hour, this certain product is generated. So that before coming it as a byproduct, generated and as a byproduct, at that particular time in the reaction, you can stop that product formation. Okay, so you are monitoring the reactions. You are monitoring the reactions. How you can monitor the reactions? By analytical techniques, by sensors. Okay, so that is called as real-time analysis. So use various techniques to monitor reaction, to prevent any accident, to prevent any formation of toxic substance. This is called as real-time monitoring. You are continuously monitoring the reaction from start to end so that you are controlling the formation of hazardous substance. Methods are to be developed to monitor our reactions. Very, very important. Okay. Yes, students, are you aware of this Bhopal gas tragedy? You must have studied in schools, right? What was Bhopal gas tragedy? What happened in Bhopal gas tragedy? Yes, this industry, toxic methyl isocyanate gas was leaked. And because of that, there was a havoc. Many people died. They started suffering birth defects. It was horrible tragedy, and you can go Google it. You have studied it. When I was making these slides, I came across search images and I couldn't put those images over here. It was really very disturbing. Then there was the Chernobyl disaster also. Nuclear failure, nuclear reactor leakage. Again, you can Google and find out how people were affected. People are still suffering from these. And see when these had 1984, 86. See the tragedies. And there was one more in Japan. And recently also, 2-3 years back, there was one in, I forgot that name of the country. There was one more tragedy, nuclear tragedy. So we just cannot afford such tragedies. And in chemical industries, we are always prone to such accidents. This is because of the way we carry out our reactions. Our reaction needs high temperature. We are carrying out reactions on larger scales in industries. So there are a lot of chemicals involved. There are a lot of toxic solvents involved. And if you don't carry out reactions carefully, then there is chance of a accident and people die in these accidents. So it's very, very important how you are carrying out these reactions. So instead of, you know, so the best way is you to design a safer chemistry. Okay, safer chemistry. You modify the synthesis, you modify the process, so that if you are carrying out this process and on a larger scale in industry, accidents are stopped. Your life is safe. Are you getting this? So, where are the accidents? Recycling of solvents, high temperature. Okay, so you design your synthesis in such a way. Substances used in chemical process should be chosen to minimize the risk of accident prevention. There was an incident long back where in an industry they had this huge drum of oxalyl chloride, COCl2, and the person who was operating that accidentally fell into that. And that is a very, very toxic gas. Imagine when a small drop of H2SO4 falls on your skin, how you people start to react, right? And then this person fell into that COCl2 drum, and what must have happened to that person? Imagine the kind of incident. So such type of incidents do take place in industries. Unless and until we design a new way, we cannot stop all these accidents. Okay. So these are all the 12 principles. I will put up this video. You will come to know. You can just take a screenshot of this afterwards. This is how you can remember. Prevent waste, renewable materials. Okay, so this is a shortcut to remember the 12 principles. Apply these 12 principles in your day-to-day life. So quickly, I will just go through the goals and need of chemistry. It is required to design sustainable environment, cost-effective, pollution prevention. Product should be such that it eliminates waste, less toxic, minimum waste, energy saver. Okay, environmentally friendly. All these are the needs and goals of green chemistry. This is what you are going to apply in your day-to-day life. Banish paper. Banish plastic bag. When you say plastic is replaced by paper, then again there is a lot of load on the environment because people start cutting tree. Try to carry out a reusable bag. Design a bag, stitch a bag from your old clothes. Okay, use a cloth bag. When you go to the market, if that vegetable vendor is giving you a plastic bag, ask him not to give. Stop your parents from doing that. Always take a cloth bag with you. Instead of monthly bills on paper, go for e-billing. Now everything is online today. This will reduce the paper. Before you throw anything away, ask yourself if you can use it, if you can reuse it, if you can recycle it. Are you getting this? Don't just throw anything into the water. Please, please, please. Recycle whatever you can. Try to save raw materials. Okay, try to recycle, try to reduce waste at the origin itself. Keep your house clean. Try to separate the wet waste and the dry waste at home itself. Keep two dustbins. Wet waste, you can use it for making a compost in your society. Make people aware that we will collect all the wet waste. Wet waste means what? Vegetables, leftover food. All these are the peels of the vegetables. All these are wet waste. You can prepare a good compost out of wet waste. There is no prevention option possible. So treat and safely dispose the waste. Okay, students. So I will stop here. This was very important thing. I hope you are going to follow this.